Good morning, girls. Today we are going to start our second unit. First unit is over now. Let us see the content of second unit first. Here you can see the content of second unit. The name, title of second unit is RMI and Servlet. Actually, these are two separate topics, RMI and Servlet, right? Let us cover the RMI topic first, and then we will learn how to do the programming of Servlet. Here we will cover RMI overview, RMI architecture, stub and skeleton, developing and executing RMI application. So these are the four topics of RMI, and the remaining topics: Servlet introduction, architecture of Servlet, Servlet API, Servlet lifecycle, developing and deploying servlets, handling servlet request and response, reading initialization parameters, session tracking approach, form field, cookies, servlet collaboration, and servlet with JDBC. These topics are covered under the title servlet, right? The total weightage of this unit is 20. There are many important questions we can find from this unit. Let us begin with RMI. This is theory based topic. First of all, we will cover the theory of RMI, and then we'll do the practical of RMI, right? So here you can see the content of RMI. What is RMI? Let us begin with that part. First of all, distributed application is an application which is divided more than one machine, and machines are attached using network. All of you are very well aware of distributed application, right? For example, Oracle is a distributed application where the concept of server and client comes, right? ત્યાં આગળ સર્વર અને ક્લાયન્ટનો કન્સેપ્ટ આવે છે, જેને આપણે ડિસ્ટ્રિબ્યુટેડ એપ્લિકેશન કહી શકીએ છીએ, કે જે એક કરતાં વધારે મશીનની અંદર ડિવાઈડ થયેલી હશે અને એ બધા મશીન છે નેટવર્ક થ્રુ અટેચ હોય છે. સો હોલ એપ્લિકેશન ઇઝ ડિસ્ટ્રિબ્યુટેડ વિદિન ટુ ઓર મોર મશીન્સ. In this distribution, one part of the application has authority to get request from other part of application, which is known as application server. See, here we are talking about the whole application, ek aakhi application, which is divided into two separate machines. Ekaj application ne aapde be alag alag machine par install kariye chhe, right? In this application, the one part from where we get the request is known as application. That part is known as application. જ્યાંથી આપણને રિક્વેસ્ટ આવે છે એ મશીન છે, એ પાર્ટ છે, એ પાર્ટને આપણે એપ્લિકેશન પાર્ટ કહીએ છીએ, એપ્લિકેશન સર્વર કહીએ છીએ. એન્ડ ધ અધર પાર્ટ ઓફ એપ્લિકેશન હેઝ authority to make a request to the server. આ જે ડિસ્ટ્રિબ્યુટેડ સિસ્ટમ છે એની અંદર એક પાર્ટ એવો છે કે જ્યાં એપ્લિકેશનને એપ્લિકેશનની જે રિક્વેસ્ટ છે એને આપણે એક્ઝિક્યુટ કરાવીએ છીએ, રાઈટ? દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ સર્વર પાર્ટ. અને જે બીજો પાર્ટ છે કે જ્યાંથી રિક્વેસ્ટ આવે છે, દેટ ઇઝ કોલ્ડ ક્લાયન્ટ પાર્ટ or client application. I repeat, in the distributed system, basically there are two parts. One part is it has authority to get request from other part of application, which is known as application server, and from where we get the request is known as client application, right? Nowadays, most of the development and deployment environment is network based. So distributed application become so popular. Everywhere you can see the use of distributed applications, right? તમે ઓનલાઈન શોપિંગથી લઈ અને કોઈ પણ વેબ એપ્લિકેશન જેનો તમે તમારા ડેઈલી રૂટીન યુઝમાં લેવો છો, એ ઓલમોસ્ટ બધી એપ્લિકેશન છે એ ડિસ્ટ્રીબ્યુટેડ એપ્લિકેશન્સ હોય છે, રાઈટ? કેમ કે તમે રિક્વેસ્ટ સેન્ડ કરો છો અને સર્વર સાઇટ પર ધ સર્વર મશીન જનરેટ્સ ધ રિઝલ્ટ, process the query and generate the result and get back to you and return it back to you, right? So it distributed system thai. In distributed application, following different types of method invocation are used. Have method itle pan tamne idea che. Method means a function. Ine activate karva mateni ahiya agar different methods નું લિસ્ટ આપેલું છે. નંબર વન ઇઝ ડિસ્ટ્રીબ્યુટેડ કમ્પ્યુટિંગ એન્વાયરમેન્ટ, DCE. નેક્સ્ટ DCOM, ડિસ્ટ્રીબ્યુટેડ કોમ્પોનન્ટ્સ ઓબ્જેક્ટ મોડલ. નંબર થ્રી કોમન ઓબ્જેક્ટ રિક્વેસ્ટ બ્રોકર આર્કિટેક્ચર. નંબર ફોર જાવા રિમોટ મેથડ ઇન્વોકેશન, right? So these are the four methods through which we can invoke the method which is reside inside the server machine. Fine, I repeat: DCE, DCOM, CORBA and RMI. These four methods. Then we will learn only the fourth one. Other three are not included in our syllabus. RMI stands for Remote Method Invocation. Please note down all the full forms of all abbreviations. Here DCE, DCOM, CORBA and RMI. The full form of RMI is Remote Method Invocation. This method allow a Java object to invoke method of an object running on another machine. આપણે જે અત્યારે સ્ટડી કરવાના છીએ RMI method, એની અંદર જાવાનો ઓબ્જેક્ટ છે એ કોઈક એક મશીન ઉપર હશે અને એ બીજા મશીનની અંદર જે સ્ટોર થયેલી મેથડ છે એને રન કરાવશે. આઈ રિપીટ, અ જાવા ઓબ્જેક્ટ ટુ ઇન્વોક અ મેથડ ઓફ એન ઓબ્જેક્ટ રનિંગ ઓન અનધર મશીન. We are going to develop that method through Java coding. RMI provide a remote communication between Java program. Through RMI, we can communicate between more than two machines, right? The machine which is far away from client machine is known as remote machine. And the communication between these two machines is known as remote communication. Through we can interact between the application and server, client application and server application. RMI is used for building a distributed application. This is a type of Java program through which we can create or build a distributed application. Fine. In overview, let us see the overview of RMI application. A RMI application can be divided into two different parts: client program and a server program. A server program creates some remote object and make the references available for the client. And the client use these references to invoke a method stored on a server program. A client program make a request for a remote object on the server and invoke an appropriate method on them. Here, client program send a request to the server program through the remote object, which is stored on server. Why they use the remote object? Remote objects are used to invoke a method which are stored on the server program, server side programs, right? RMI provides the mechanism by which the server and the RMI provides the mechanism by which the server and the client communicates and pass the information back and forth. Here, what is the meaning of back and forth? To send and receive, right? To send it to the server and get back the response to the client, and vice versa. That is called back and forth. RMI is a technique through which the server and the client can communicate with each other. They can pass the information to each other, right? Such an application is referred as a distributed object application. This type of application is considered as distributed application, where the concept of client and server comes. Distributed object application needs to locate a remote object. Remote means far, which is stored on a different machine in computer language. Here, any type of distributed application required the following things. Number one is to locate a remote object. Application can use one of the mechanism to obtain a reference to the remote object. An application can register its remote object with RMI simple naming facility, the RMI registry. Here we will get RMI registry facility, which is a naming facility provided by RMI to register the remote object of application. The application can pass and return remote object references as a part of its normal operation. This object will be used as a reference to get to invoke the method. Second is communicate with remote object. Once we get the reference of object, we can communicate with the remote object to the server machine. Details of communication between remote object are handled by RMI to the programmer. Remote communication looks like a standard Java method invocation, as we do in our normal programming, where we create one object of class, and then with the object of that class we can call the method. Same here, once you define or get a reference of any remote object, you can communicate with a remote method like a standard Java method invocation. You cannot find any difference between this invocation, this type of RMI invocation, and our normal communication, right? હું તમને એક્સપ્લેન કરીશ એ વસ્તુ જ્યારે આપણે પ્રેક્ટિકલી પરફોર્મ કરશું ત્યારે તમને આઈડિયા આવી જશે. નેક્સ્ટ પોઈન્ટ ઇઝ લોડ ક્લાસ બાઇટ કોડ્સ ફોર ઓબ્જેક્ટ ધેટ આર પાસ્ડ અરાઉન્ડ. બીકોઝ RMI અલાઉઝ અ કોલર ટુ પાસ ઓબ્જેક્ટ ટુ રિમોટ ઓબ્જેક્ટ, RMI પ્રોવાઈડ ધ નેસેસરી મિકેનિઝમ ફોર લોડિંગ એન ઓબ્જેક્ટ કોડ એઝ વેલ એઝ ફોર ટ્રાન્સમિટિંગ ઇટ્સ ડેટા. After connecting with the remote object and getting the control on method invocation, it loads the class bytecode for object and that are passed around. Again, this mechanism is provided by RMI. Here, the illustration depicts an RMI distributed application that uses the registry to obtain a reference to a remote object. The server calls the registry to associate. Associate means to bind a name with a remote object. and the client looks up the remote object by its name in the server registry and then invoke a method on it. Here you can see the diagram of RMI distributed application. See, client which is finding a reference of object in registry, server send the name of object or register the name of object in registry, then client get the control of that object through a naming facility, and then with the help of that object client can run the method which is stored in server, and then after executing that method client machine can show the result on a web URL. Fine. This picture is important for your exams. What is RMI architecture? The RMI system consists of three layers. Number one is application layer. Second is stub and skeleton layer. Third one is remote reference layer. And fourth is transport layer. Basically, there are three layers, but the last layer is divided into two separate layers, remote reference layer and transport layer. I repeat the name of these layers. Number one is application layer. Second is stub and skeleton layer. Next, remote reference layer. And fourth one is transport layer. Application layer, through which we can communicate with server. The second layer, stub and skeleton layer. The stub layer is stored in client machine and skeleton layer is stored in server machine. The remote reference layer behavior, such as invocation to a single object or to a replicated object, and the actual communication done through the fourth layer, transport layer. It is connection setup and management and remote object tracking. The application layer sits on the top of the RMI system. Here you can see the architecture of RMI. Again, this is an important question for final exams. See, the topmost layer is application layer, which sits on the top of the RMI system, the first layer, right? Application layer. The relationship between the layers are shown in this figure. Client application is connected with stub. Stub is connected with remote reference layer. Remote reference layer can talk with transport layer, vice versa. Here you can see the bidirectional arrow, right? Then remote reference layer can talk with skeleton. Skeleton means a proxy layer which is stored in server-side application. Again, skeleton is connected with server application. Everywhere you can find, you can see the bidirectional arrows, right? So if layers je che ek bija sathe communicate karave kari shake che evu e batave che. A remote method invocation from a client to a remote server object travels down through the layers of RMI system to the client side transport, then up through the server side transport to the server. When a remote object is referenced, the object is not sent over the network to the client that requests it. Instead, a proxy object, often referred as a stub, proxy object of client side is known as stub, which is client side proxy for the remote object, is sent. The client interacts only with the stub class. The stub class is responsible for handling data between the local and a remote system. One remote object can be referenced by many clients. In that case, each client has its own stub object. See, I repeat, focus on this line. One remote object can be referenced by many clients. Server creates only one remote object, right? Which can be referenced by many clients. In that case, each client has its own stub object. Remote object che ek j hase, which can be referenced by more than one client, right? And each client generates its own stub object. E reference mate client che e potana stub object che e generate karse. Which represents that remote object? Ki je remote object ne represent kartu hase. But in no case is the remote object duplicated. સર્વરે ક્રિએટ કરેલા રિમોટ ઓબ્જેક્ટનું ડુપ્લિકેશન થશે નહીં. યુ વિલ ગેટ ઓનલી વન ઓબ્જેક્ટ ઓફ રિમોટ ટાઈપ, રાઈટ? દેટ વિલ બી શેર્ડ બાય ઓલ ધ ક્લાયન્ટ્સ અટેચ વિથ દેટ એપ્લિકેશન, એન્ડ ઓલ ધ ક્લાયન્ટ્સ ક્રિએટ્સ દેર ઓન સ્ટબ ઓબ્જેક્ટ્સ ફોર દેટ પર્ટિક્યુલર વન રિમોટ ઓબ્જેક્ટ. A skeleton class is responsible for handling over the method, class and data to the actual object being referenced on the server side. This acts as the server side proxy for the object that is being exported. Je server side mate no je layer che proxy layer ene apde skeleton layer kesu. Stub and skeleton are two important objects used for communication with remote object. Again, stub and skeleton. This is a most important question of this chapter. Note down in your notebook. Stub act as a gateway for client program. It resides on client side and communicate with skeleton object through the internet. It establish the connection between remote object and transmit the request to it. What we can do with the help of stub and skeleton? This both proxy servers are required to establish the connection between remote object, and they are required to transmit the request to each other. Skeleton object reside on server program. It is responsible for passing request from stub to remote object. The remote reference layer of the architecture gets a stream-oriented connection from the transport layer. Stream-oriented here means the byte stream. We are talking about the byte stream. It is responsible for dealing with the semantic. Semantic means concerned with interpretation. Semantic means concerned with interpretation, how to interpret the byte stream, right? It is responsible for dealing with the semantic of remote invocation. It is also responsible for handling duplicate objects and for performing implementation specific task with a remote object. Here we discussed that there are many client objects, stub type client objects. So to handle them properly, the remote reference layer is required. Next layer is transport layer. The transport layer is responsible for setting up the connection and transportation of data from one machine to another. Actual communication is done through this layer only. It transport the data from the client machine to server machine. and vice versa, right? It transport the data from one machine to another machine. It is a setup for transporting a data from one machine to another machine with the help of TCP/IP protocol. The actual implementation of the client-server application take place at the application layer. Any application that makes some of its method available to its remote client must first declare the method in an interface that extends java.rmi.remote, which is an empty interface. See, when we will do the practical, we will also create one interface which would be an empty interface. The main difference between the remote and normal interface is that the remote interface throws the remote exception. We all knows very well how to create interface in Java, right? Here in RMI, again, we have to create one interface. But the difference between the remote and normal interface is mainly the remote interface throws the remote exception, whereas the normal interface does not throw the remote exception, right? And the remote interface always extends java.rmi.remote package in the beginning. If a class is to implement this remote interface, it must first implement the unicast remote object in the java.rmi.server package. What we have to do if we want to implement this remote interface in our Java coding? For that, we need to implement the unicast remote object in java.rmi.server package, right? Again, I will show the use of this interface in our practicals. Finally, the application registers itself with a naming server or the registry with the name. This name can be used. This name can be used to contact the application and obtain the reference to its remote objects. The client simply requests the remote object from the registry with a given name. How to access the name of that object through the registry, that I will show you in practical session. The reference to the remote object is cast to one of its remote interfaces in order to call the remote method. Later on, we will use that reference to call the remote methods which are stored in the registry. The high level calls can then access and export a remote object. Okay. Now, after the discussion of RMI theory, let us see the steps to create a RMI application. Here you can see the simple steps in theoretical form to create a simple RMI application using Java code, right? To develop the following Java files, we need to use java.rmi packages and java.rmi server package. The first step is to define a remote interface, as we have discussed in the previous topic. First of all, we have to create an empty interface, which is called remote interface. Number two is implement that remote interface somewhere in our Java code. Number three, create and start remote applications. And finally, step number four, create and start client application. Let us see the steps in detail. Number one is define a remote interface. A remote interface specifies the method that can be invoked remotely by a client. See, remote interface which specify the method that can be invoked remotely by a client. Client's program communicate to remote interface, not to classes implementing it, right? Whenever you call the method through the client program, that communicate to a remote interface, not to the classes implementing this remote interfaces. To be a remote interface, an interface must extend the remote interface of java.rmi package. Here you can see the coding part of defining a remote interface. See, import java.rmi.star. This is a most important package required for remote communication, right? Then we will create a public interface for remote application. Here, public interface, the name of this interface is add server interface, which extends remote class, which is inbuilt class. Then inside this interface, we will create a method which we want to call in client application, public integer sum. Sum is a name of method and it has two parameters, integer A, integer B. So this is a creation of remote interface, right? Very simple. As I discussed in the previous point, that here the difference is only we must import a java.rmi at the beginning of the creation of this interface, right? Otherwise it looks like a normal interface. Then second step is implementation of remote interface. For implementation of remote interface, a class must either extend unicast remote object or use export object method of unicast remote object class. I repeat, for implementation of remote interface, a class must either extend unicast remote object or use export object method of unicast remote object class. The Java RMI server package has most of the core classes and interfaces that are necessary to export a remote object in our program. It contains most of the classes needed for implementing RMI. The main class in this package is unicast remote object class. This class supplies the TCP based references which is required for the transportation. So here, every time we include this package, here you can see the coding part. Import java.rmi and import java.rmi.server. These two packages are required. Then we will create a class, public class adder, which extends unicast remote object, as we have discussed, right? And this implement the add server interface which we have created in the first step. This code is not mandatory. This part is not mandatory. Let us omit this part. Now the method which is declared in add server interface, we will create a body for that method over here. You can see the body part, public integer sum, integer A, integer B. What we want to do in this method, see here, for the sake of simplicity, here I have not done the lengthy programming, right? I have just done the addition of these two numbers, and this method will return the addition of these two numbers by return keyword, return A plus B. Now the third step is create add server and host RMI service. You need to create a server application and host RMI service adder in it. This is done using the rebind method of java.rmi.naming class. Rebind method take two arguments. First, represent the name of the object reference, and the second argument is reference to instance of adder method. Right? import java.rmi registry. See, here we will go to find the name in registry. For that, here we included the package java.rmi.registry. Now create one class of type public. Public class add server. Public static void main. String args. Inside the try block, we will create one object of add server interface with name add service. Right? We will create an object of add server interface. Here the name of object is add service. Now we will use rebind method of naming class. naming.rebind add service and add service. The first argument, this one, the selected part, the first argument represent the name of the object reference which is available in registry, right? And the second argument is reference to the instance of this object. The second argument is the reference through which we want to find this object in registry is add service. Add service is object which is hosted with the name add service, right? Here you can see the difference in these two names. Here the first letter is in capital, and here in the second argument the first letter is in small letters. So this is the rebind method which accept two arguments. First is the name of the object reference which is stored in registry, and the second argument is reference to the instance of that object reference, right? This is our third step. Now fourth step is to create client application. Client application contains a Java program that invoke the lookup method of the naming class. This method accepts one argument, the RMI URL, and return a reference to an object of type add server interface. All remote method invocation is done on this object. Here import java.rmi.star. This package is required. Then public class client, public static void main method, add server interface, we'll create an object of this interface with name st, add server interface, naming dot lookup, this will find for the name, reference name in the registry. We will pass this name through the command line, right? And args will accept that argument. Then system.out.println, we will call the method sum with the help of the object st of at server interface. As you know that sum method will accept two arguments, so here we have passed two arguments, right? 25 and 8. This will return an addition of these two numbers, and this will be printed by, that answer will be printed by system.out.println method. So these are the steps to build an RMI application, right? Little bit complicated atyare tamne complicated lagtu hase, pan jyare apne practical implementation start karsu tyare exactly tamne idea aavse how to use lookup method, how to use rebind method, how to create remote interface, how to implement that interface for creating our application, right? And how to create stub and skeleton, and how to create a client application. So this much is enough for today's session. In the next session, we will discuss how to actually implement this RMI method invocation, right? Remote method invocation technique through Java code, and how to execute this program. Thank you.